Church Relations Committee. Starts conference November the 8th, 10 p.m. right here in the sanctuary. We will be hosting another cluster of church groups. There are 4 or 5 of them. We will be here. I need new officers especially to make that calendar date and need you here.
Can you pull it out?
Pull it out?
From underneath the...
Did they not hear anything I said? I need to start over. November the 8th, 2 o'clock p.m. here in the sanctuary. There's a sign-up sheet back there for flowers, for the altar flowers. We need people to look at that and see if you can help us out. We have several days that are unattended at this particular moment. So be kind enough to look at that. Susan, I know you've got at least 2 announcements to attend.
I do. Thank you. Good morning. The Outreach and Member Support Committee is happy to announce that we are going forward with our small groups. Believe it or not, it was a year ago that we started these, and they've been wildly successful. So I have so many, I have to have a cheat sheet. 4 for 4 is a meeting of groups of 4 who meet once a month for 4 months. And instead of signing up for a particular group, you just put your name down and I will shake them all up and assign you a group. The Bad Girls, after a successful study, have given way to Remarkable Women. We thought we'd go from bad to good. And we meet twice a month on Tuesdays, and the sign-up sheet is back there. The Christian Craft Mamas, thanks to Michelle Falstich, is continuing on. Here's a new group, Let's Eat Out, which is primarily probably for single people. It could be breakfast, lunch, or dinner. So if you're interested in that, please sign up. And after a game night a year ago, there was interest in euchre and dominoes, so we have a sign up if you like to play games. And a new sign up is for those who are struggling with the grief and loneliness. So there is a sheet back there. Barb Friesner has expressed interest in that, so contact her for more information. And last but not least is the Women's Retreat, October 24th at Lindenwood. Our own Barbie Pickett is helping to lead the story that everybody has a story. Lunch will be provided by Earthworks and promises to be a memorable day. Sign-up sheet is in the back. If you have any questions, let me know, or Chris in the office, or anyone on the member of support and outreach committee.
Sign-up
sheets are in the back.
Let me contact you about other details.
Absolutely.
Okay. There's a children's sermon scheduled back there as well. We've got about 8 or 9 people that have signed up for that on a rotational basis. If you sign up now, you would actually not start until January because we're already filled out for the year. If you'd like to get on that, I have resource material for you. If you get interested in doing something like that, but you don't want to create one on your own, I have some resource for you if you'd like to participate in that process. Okay. Anybody else? Just hold up your hand. We will have an usher bring the microphone right to you.
May I just say something real quick? All of the faithful Christo script writers, I have Christo's back in stock.
The loyal Christo buyer.
I just wanted to announce that Smile will be happening about a month from now, the October 23rd and 24th. It is for 5th through 8th graders. And again, ladies, I will be in the back and I really, really need help in the kitchen during the meal times. We have dinner, breakfast, and lunch. So I just need 1 to 2 women in the kitchen during those times to kind of just help prepare the meal. And if you're interested in not helping that way and instead just giving food or in any way, shape, or form, I would be so happy to talk with you after church. Also, Junior Church will be starting next Sunday. We'll be doing videos and little crafts every Sunday, and I will be leading that. So send your children downstairs. Thank you.
And then once again, there's another sign-up sheet back there for the older nursery. And please need people, the more people we have on there, the less you have to do with. So we can get like 10 people, and then we only have to do it two or three times a year. We really appreciate your sign up. Thank you.
I'm on the exec board for the Plymouth High School Rally Dance Marathon, and this year one of our fundraisers is we're selling Krispy Kreme donuts. These are $8 for a dozen of glazed and $9 for glazed with chocolate icing. Let me know if you want to purchase any. I will be in the back afterwards and just give you your name, what you want, the money, and then pickup will be next Saturday, the 26th, yes, 9 to 11 a.m. at door 5 of the high school. And if you need me to pick them up, I can pick them up and bring them to church the following day. Thanks.
How many does it take you want?
As many as you want.
You're on. Your battery dead?
Must be. I'll change batteries here in just a second. Any other announcements, please? All right. Are you ready to worship then?
Oh,
There was a loud noise in the back. Okay. Once upon a time, there was a cowboy who had a big ranch in Lukenbach, Texas. Anybody know about Lukenbach, Texas? Yeah, there's a few. And he had a big ranch. Well, that cowboy got so involved in his ranch that he actually forgot about going to church. And it was a long time before he realized it was important for him to go to church. He had just let his ranch take over his thinking. One day he realized it. So on Sunday morning, he got up and he took his shower. He put on his best cowboy pants. He put on his best cowboy shirt and his best cowboy belt and his best cowboy vest and his best cowboy shoes. He took his cowboy hat and he went out and got on his horse and he rode to the church in Lukenbach. When he got to church, he got off his horse and tied it up on the hitching post. And when he went into the church, he took off his hat. And he took his hat off while he was going into the church because he knew he loved God and he wanted to show respect. So he took his hat off. And then he went into the church and he sat down, placed his hat beside him, and he listened to music. He listened to the sermon, and he listened to more music. When the church service was over, the cowboy picked up his hat and carried it towards the door to leave. And when he got close to the door, there was someone in the church, a man in the church came up to him, and he said, "Well, we're so glad you're here today." And the cowboy said, "Thank you, sir." And he said, "I hope that you'll come back another day." And the cowboy said, "I think that I will, sir. Thank you." And then the man said, "And by the way, the next time you come, would you think about the dress that you're, how you're dressed when you come to our church?" And the cowboy looked at him and said, "I'll pray about it." He took his hat and he left, got on his horse and rode back home. Next Sunday, he decided he was going to go to church. And he got up, took his shower. He got on his best cowboy pants. He got on his best cowboy shirt. He got on his best cowboy belt. And his best cowboy vest. And his best cowboy shoes. And he cut his hat. And he went out to his horse. And he rode to church. When he got to church, he tied his horse up the hitch and went into the church. And as he went in, he took off his hat because he respected God. He went in and sat down and put his hat beside him. He listened to the music and he listened to the sermon and he listened to the music some more. And when the church was over, he got up, took his hat, and he walked towards the end, outside, towards the door of the church. And the same man greeted him as he met him last time. And the man said, "Oh, we're so glad you're here today." And the cowboy said, "Thank you, sir." And the man said, "We hope that you'll come back another Sunday." And the cowboy said, "I hope that I do." And then the man said, "Did you happen to think about the clothing that we talked about it when you come to our church?" And the cowboy said, "You know, I prayed about that. I prayed about that a lot." And the man said, "Well, what did you find out?" And the cowboy said, "Well, sir, the Lord said, I don't know what to tell you to wear to that church because I've never been in that church." So the man took his hat, left the church, got on his horse, and rode home. Now the story, the message about the story is not kip-poppy, but it's something similar. The idea of coming to church is God does not care who you are. He does not care how you look.
He does not care how you dress. He just wants you to come to church, and he wants him to have you learn more about him and to love him. And that's our message, and that's a good reason to have a prayer. Let's have prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you very much for the ability to be at this church and have all these people around us. And we understand that you don't care what we look like. You don't care how we dress. You don't care who we are other than knowing that we love you. And we come here to learn more about you. And that is a real honor. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, I have something for you. Amen. If you please.
Deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, and the power,
and glory forever. Amen. Would you take a few moments and stand with me, please? Let's find somebody that you've not yet greeted this morning and welcome them to this worship hour.
Thank you. Thank you.
On the back page of your bulletin, you'll find our scripture lesson for this morning. If you would stand with me, please. We talked last week about Mark and Mark's scripture about how Jesus asked two very important questions. Remember the question? First one was, who do people say that I am? And he already knew that answer. What he wanted to know is what his disciples were thinking and saying about him, and have them to make that commitment aloud. Several of them said, you're Elijah, you're John the Baptist, resurrected. Others say you're one of the great prophets. It was Peter who said, you're the Son of the living God, you're the Messiah. The correct answer. I'm not sure that Peter and the rest of the guys actually understood what that meant to them. So on through the sermon, I was asking you to tell me why you were here. Why do you come to this place? Why do you support this particular church? Simply because your parents told you so? Because it's the habitual thing to do? Your answer is so important and so vital for the life and the future of this church. And I hope you went home and thought about that. At least came to the conclusion, do you know your why? The reason that you were here. Mark is going to help us answer the question. Would you read with me, please, as we find this to be the inspired word of God? They left that place and passed through Galilee. Jesus did not want anyone to know where they were, because he was teaching his disciples. He said to them, the Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. They will kill him, and after 3 days he will rise. But they did not understand what he meant, and were afraid to ask him about it. They came to Capernaum. When he was in the house, he asked them, what were you arguing about on the road? But they kept quiet, the way they had argued about who was the greatest. Sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, anyone who wants to be first must be the very last and the servant of all. He took a little child whom he placed among them. Taking the child in his arms, he said to them, whoever welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me does not welcome me, but the one who sent me. This is the word of the Lord. Thank you. Won't you be seated, please? Let me tell you something. As you're sitting down, we've got a new clicker. It's not the size of a cigar. I've never had any clicker any bigger than that. Now, we tried it this week, and it seemed to work okay. But James, if something goes awry, we'll back me. We'll try it this morning and see how it goes. Please be with me in a moment of prayer, and let's prepare our prayer. Who's number one? There are all kinds of arenas in which we could answer that question. Who's your number one friend? Who's your number one parent? Who's your number one grandparent? Who's your best friend? Who's the greatest? We all know that Muhammad Ali said that a long time ago, but he's been surpassed many times. But it's a spiritual question that we're being asked to answer. Who's number one? I'm afraid in America we have seemingly lost our ability to serve and our need to be served. We like to be catered to. We like to have people come and wait upon us. When in fact, we're the ones church that are called to be servants and in good servitude. Lord, help us to understand what our role is, not only within this church, but then within our community where we have our life and our income. We ask you to be with us through the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I have discovered that one of the quickest ways that I can start a fight between sports fans is to ask, who's the greatest? Since this is the beginning of the football season, I thought maybe we would start by who's the greatest quarterback? Who do you think, Peyton Manning or Tom Brady? Bar star, Sonny Jervis. Oh, there are so many. But in a sort of modern day era, I guess. Yeah, you guys can choose on that. Well, let's go someplace else. Let's go to golf. I like golf. There are several golfers down here. Who do you think would win that match between Jack Nicklaus in his prime or Tiger Woods in his prime? Who would say? Some say Jack, some say Tiger. Well, let's go back a few more years and see what we've got. what's the choir then? Larry Bird, number 33. Let me tell you a quick story about Larry Bird. There was a young man by the name of Eric Torpy, T-O-R-P-Y, who just was infatuated with Larry Bird. Now, Torpy had some problems with the law from time to time, and he was finally arrested, was found guilty of attempted robbery and attempted murder, and he was sentenced by the judge to 30 years in prison. Well, Torpy stood up and said, "Judge, why not make it 33? And the judge said, "Well, why in the world would I want to do 33 years?" And he said, "Because my favorite basketball player is Larry Bird, and that's the number on his jersey. And the judge said, "Okay." About 5 years into his sentence, Mr. Torpy said, "Oh, I wish I'd have kept my big mouth shut." Now, I know I didn't mention everybody's favorite greatest sports figure. Let me give you one other story that may help set up. The Edmonton Oilers, who are the National Hockey League team, had a coach by the name of Ted Green. And Ted Green's best player, a young man by the name of Sean Van Allen, was in an accidental crush playing golf, playing hockey, and he had a concussion. And the concussion led to the fact that Sean Van Allen couldn't remember who he was. So the doctors went to Coach and said, "Coach, Sean Van Allen can't remember his name." And this is what Ted Green said: "Tell him he's Wayne Gretzky, maybe he'll play better." Boy, the drive to become number one is as old as the first family, and I don't mean the one in the White House. Cain and Abel. Big discussion resulted in murder. The drive to become number one is as old as Jacob and Esau. The drive to become number one is as old as Joseph and his 11 brothers. And it hasn't stopped. It won't stop. The need to become number one is something that we may be wired for in our particular life. The drive to become the greatest, listen now, has even infected the disciples of Jesus Christ. Jesus and the disciples are passing through Northwest Galilee. They're headed toward Capernaum. It was the first leg of Jesus' journey on his route ultimately to Jerusalem and crucifixion. Jesus wanted to keep the presence of himself and the 12 quiet because he wanted the 12 and himself to be isolated. He wants to have their undivided attention. He wants to teach them. He wanting to prepare the disciples for what they had. Traveling along those dusty roads in northern Judea, Jesus notices that the disciples are bickering about something. I think he probably really knew. But he sees them arguing. And when they stop for the night, build their camp, Jesus asks them, "What were you arguing about on the road?" Scripture says they all kept their silence because they were ashamed that they had been arguing about who among them was the greatest. Now, matters of rank are important in any organization, so it is probably very natural for the disciples to be concerned about their status or their status in Jesus' coming kingdom. They know it's coming, they're not sure exactly what that is, but they're jockeying for position. Well, you did that well last week, but you didn't do that so well the week before. And they're arguing among themselves as to who gets the greatest. You might think that such a conversation would have produced a migraine and a headache in the Messiah, but it did not, at least not in this case. Evidently, he understood such feelings. He understood that that drive to achieve, that drive maybe to become number one, is innate inside of the human being. It's part of who we are. It may be we were wired that way from God. And after sitting down, which is the recognized position of a Jewish teacher, Jesus gathers the 12 around him and begins to teach them. And he says this: if anyone wants to be first in the kingdom, he or she must be willing to be the last and the servant of all. Notice how he reads that. Sitting down, Jesus calls the 12, anyone who wants to be first must be the very last and the servant of all. See, he's not saying to the disciples it's bad to be number one. He doesn't say that at all. He is saying, and he's telling them how to get there. If you want to be first, if you want to be the greatest, here's what you must do. You must be willing to serve. Which is not the societal moray of his time, nor the societal moray of our time. Jesus is not condemning their ambition. He's telling them how to get to your point of reference. You want to be the greatest? Let me show you how. Would you agree that a person with no ambition, no emotion, is kind of a drag on society? Maybe you know the story of Mildred Benson, who was a columnist for the Toledo Blade paper in Toledo, Ohio. Benson's husband was diagnosed as being terminally ill, and to provide for her family, Miss Benson began devoting her spare time to her dream, which was to write. She had nurtured that for many years, and under the pen name of Carolyn Keene, anybody know the name yet? Carolyn Keene. She began writing mysteries for young women. You may have heard of the character in those mysteries. Her name was Nancy Drew. Benson was surprised at the impact of the resourceful fictional character on the lives of her many readers, because she was getting feedback from other women that said, this is great. You know, keep sending this stuff. Many women found it inspirational to improve their lives through Nancy Drew's example. Benson's parents didn't think she could even write. Her father was convinced she'd never make a living at it. She had a dream. She had a lofty ambition. She knew her why in life. And she became internationally known. No shame in being ambitious, as long as you do not abuse other people achieving your ambitions, and as long as you have that balance between you, your gift, your God, and your church, and other people. I think sometimes in America, we think too much about the financial end of it, and we lose the spiritual end of it, and we become out of balance. Jesus says there's nothing wrong with being ambitious, but keep it in balance with your life. Keep it in balance. Now, Jesus is making the point that the greatness in his kingdom, notice in his kingdom, is determined by service and not status. Jesus is making the point to us as well. If you want to be first, if you want to be the greatest, here's what you should do. You must learn to serve others. That's what we said up here. That's our watchword, that's our mission, that's our statement. Love God, love others, and serve others. What is Jesus? Jesus doing? He's actually conducting the first seminar on spiritual success. Every business person in this room knows that to be successful, to be number one in your business, whatever that may be for you, you have to gain and perpetuate a reputation for service. You go to a restaurant, they're not there to take your order within 4 or 5 minutes, and the food comes and it's cold. The waiter or waitress is a little jerky. You're not going back there. You're going to tell others not to go there. Thomas Watson, who started IBM back in the 40s, had three core values for his business, and they're listed there below. Excellent products, excellent customer service, and respect for the customer. Does that make sense? It's just common sense. On how to get a business up and running and valuable. Note this also, please. Let me try to get in. In the Greek, Mark uses the word diakonos for the word servant, which means one who attends the needs of others freely and willingly. Here's my point. He does not use the Greek word doulos, which literally means in servitude, under obligation and compulsion. That's a slave. And you're working as a slave. So Mark is very clear here that he wants you to be of diakonos, helpful. Quite a contrast between the two. It's an important distinction because we are asked to serve God and serve others freely, joyfully, out of a sense of love, not out of a sense of obligation and duty. It's interesting how Jesus makes his entire point. He sets a small child among all the disciples, and taking that child in his arms, perhaps like the picture that we have on the front of the bulletin for you this morning, he says that whoever welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes me. And not only me, but the one who sent me. In contrast, both Jewish and Greek-Roman societies of that time considered children to be the least important in all of society. They were sold, they were traded, they were bartered. Those societies at that time idolized the mature adult, especially the males, to welcome and to show kindness to one of these little ones. Is the equivalent of welcoming Jesus Christ into your heart. But not only him, but the one who sent him. God is not concerned about titles and reputation or position or status. He cares not whether you're the CEO or you're the one who sweeps the floor of the business. Titles don't impress God. And titles do not qualify you as a man or a woman. What qualifies you in God's eyes is your willingness to serve. In God's kingdom, I must assess that the greatest value is servanthood. I hope you look forward to the balance of the rest of your life and you will determine what legacy you are going to leave behind. Will you seek to make this world a better place than when you came into it? What kind of legacy will you be leaving behind? I'm not worried that you're leaving behind some legacy of evil, but I want to know how much good you're going to leave behind. Will people be blessed because of your presence here on the face of this earth? Will they remember you because you worshiped and served out of this particular church? Some of you will remember the name of David Thomas. David was the founder of the Wendy's fast food chain industry. He died in 2002. David's congenial face became a very familiar sight to millions of people who watched him on his company's television commercials. David Thomas is a remarkable story in its own right. He was an adopted child. I don't know if you even knew that. Never finished high school. But David said he got his MBA before he got his GED. following, a snazzy knee-length work apron. He claims that he is the only founder of America's largest companies who supports a mop bucket and dirty water. Not a gag, it's actually on his corporate report. He calls it leading by example. At Wendy's, he says, MBA does not mean Masters of Business Administration, it means mop bucket attitude. Mop bucket attitude. It means literally a commitment to serve others. David Thomas taught all of his employees and wanted that to send down to the very least of his people. But service is what made success for him. The Wendy's owner, David Thomas, could have just as well read it right out of the scripture, because that's exactly what Jesus Christ said. Service is the lesson that David Thomas leaves to his company. Service to others is the lesson that Jesus Christ leaves to our church. And how did Jesus show his servitude? He wrapped a towel around his waist, and he knelt before all 12 of the disciples and washed their feet. What corporate CEO, CFO would do that today? Philip Yancey is one of the great American writers. He's written several books, and this church has used some of them for Sunday school material and Bible study. The first book he ever wrote was the one that's listed there, that Jesus I Never Knew. And in that, he writes this: you can gauge the size of a ship that has passed out of sight by the huge wave it leaves behind. You understand what he's saying? Even as the boat has gone, the wake that it leaves behind, when it hits the shoreline, you can guess just about how big that boat is by the amount of the wave or the size of the waves that hit the shoreline. What kind of wake will you leave behind? What is your legacy to your family and to your church? The word is still S-E-R-V-I-C-E. Service to your family, service to your church, service to your community, and service to those who need it the most. I ask you again, who's number one? Would you bow your heads with me, please? Lord, you continue to teach us in the most unique of ways. Something as simple and as forthright as this story. Arguing about who's number one. Embarrassed when asked, what are you arguing about? Then given the why of their life. Servanthood. Servitude. It is expected of us as true disciples of Jesus Christ. Serving our family, serving our community, serving our church, and serving those who need it the most. We thank you for your instruction, and we thank you for the challenge. So we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Page number 430 in your hymnal, if you want to look at that. 430. Would you stand with me, please? If you found it at the end of the screen as well. All verses.
Thank you.
being here this morning. I know there's other places you could have been, or maybe should have been, but you are the ones who have dedicated your time, your talent to be here. And thank you for your presence. For those in the balcony, thank you for being here. For all of you, some of you here for the first time, maybe the second time, maybe for a lifetime, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for your gift. We thank you for your service. We thank you for your finances and support of this church, its mission, its outreach. Gracious Lord, we continue to thank you for our time together. We thank you for the challenge you give to us. We thank you for this pure and simple word that if we want to become number one in your eyes, we need to serve others. We have them all around us. We have homeless right here in this community. We have children who need clothing, books. We have all kinds of opportunities that we might be able to serve. Let us work forward and move forward in that position. May we be the servants you called us to be. We pray that in Jesus' name. And these people said, God is good all the time.